Okay, we've got, we're rolling.
All right, good afternoon, everybody.
Not quite yet.
We're going to have two presentations, one by Mark on the Sophia project, and we're going to have another one by Scott. And Scott, what's your project going to be?
It's a process oriented manufacturing process.
Okay. And just for your information, right now, I think I've come to the conclusion of the variation of infrastructures that even if we were to spend this afternoon having a discussion, we're not going to really come to any conclusions about any of this because there's so much variation. I think a greater level of analysis is required. And that's going to have to occur offline. And I'm going to try to do some of that in between now and conference. One of the things I'm going to do is I'm going to scan all those things that I printed out here and I'll send you. And you have a lot of codes on there, and I wasn't sure if you would want to have those listed early. So what I may ask you to do is if you could, you know, kind of provide a generic description.
Yeah, not myself. I have no idea what I wrote.
What?
You took them.
Well, no, you're going to get the scan thing, and you'll be able to do it.
Okay.
Yeah. Not until then. And then, you know, it may result in, you know, some kind of formalized org chart, you know, and maybe a matrix, and we can kind of begin to break it in.
Characterize then maybe, you know, the different types of practices. That's what we're doing.
Right.
What is the scope of professional practice in space architecture?
Yep. So. But the very first thing I want to do, because I know we talked about trying to block out some time to talk about our preparation for this conference and some of the issues. And I just want to spend maybe about 15 minutes kind of giving you my perception of some things and talking about ways that we might improve the process next year. I'll just start off by saying that, you know, we received abstracts last November. We received 27 abstracts, and they all came in absolutely on time. Everybody was very diligent and everything came in and there were no problems. And then, you know, there were the usual things that had to happen, and then the draft deadline came. And of the 27, I think I knew at that time I was going to get something like 19 drafts. And I think on the day the drafts were due, I received 9 drafts. Now, I'm not really, you know, this is my first time doing this kind of thing. So some of you guys who have done this before, you know, may think, well, you know, that's pretty normal. I don't know. You know, I know I sent out an email prior to that day, one email, you know, saying, okay, you know, here's a heads up, you know, this is going to be happening. Maybe, you know, we need to start earlier.
Well, what Mark and I always did was fake you guys out and ended up with those deals in Paris even a couple weeks before the SAE deadline for drafts. And the draft is really the important thing that tends to happen. But once you get going on the draft, it's not that difficult to get rolling, you know, towards the final.
Well, let's not leave Andreas out of the hole on that and give him that information, because I certainly didn't know that. And as a result,
nobody intentionally, you know, forgot to share that information.
No, I'm not making any accusations at all. I'm just saying that, you know, we need to communicate.
You know,
to make things
we're just lazy, deceptive schmucks, so that was kind of how we were never
going. And the thing is, I think that if there were some kind of further advanced communication, or you know, even if you did something like that, personally, I prefer that we just did more advanced communication, you know, and try to let people know the right precise thing. Because people are busy, and you know, they're working on their paper, but they've got other things to do. And it just so happened that in my case, I was unemployed. So I was able to devote all my time to what I was doing, and I was noticing all this stuff.
Well, and the thing is, it wasn't like we were making it up. And I think Mark really was who thought this through after all that experience. So, you know, the truth is, I mean, SAE needs the drafts by next day. We're going to review them, and then we need them by at least a week before.
Yeah, well, SAE so has
a before then, because that gives us
SAE. From what I found out, has about a 2 to 3 week period of slot.
Yeah, they used to have more.
Yeah, and we even got the drafts, and that was all good. Now, in terms of reviewers, I know this is an issue that you and I have talked about, Mark and I have talked about. There is, we would discuss that if you are a member of the subcommittee, that you should...
If you're a regular member.
If you're a regular member of the subcommittee, then you are eligible to be a reviewer. And back in February, I think it was, we had a teleconference. And I think I said at that time, well, what I'll do is, you know, I'll make a little list or something like that. Anyway, based on what we had agreed to, I went ahead and fired out the abstracts. And then we had the problem, you know, at that point, that some people couldn't do it. Or, you know, some persons, you know, I don't know, sometimes emails just didn't seem to work. And papers didn't get sent through. So, and of course now, you know, the way they have this thing set up, it is a double-blind process. That is the SAE process. So, you know, I guess my recommendation on that is we have, like you were suggesting the other day, that we begin very early, probably as soon as this conference is over, in trying to identify groups of reviewers in certain disciplines and have a body of reviewers that, you know, are go-to people who are going to be willing to do this kind of thing. You know, because after the fact, you know, when everything was said and done and word kind of got out that I was looking for reviewers in a pinch, there were other people who I didn't even contact who came out of the woodwork, you know, who said that they'd be willing to do reviews. So there are people who are, have the time and the expertise that would be willing to do it. So I think we need to identify those people and then make them available to Andres so that, you know, he has a body of people that he can go to when they're dedicated, and there's a high probability they'll be able to, you know, meet the deadlines.
Yeah, other conferences that I've seen, they put together, I think that the topics, the areas of specialty, the list is going to be an important thing together, because once we have that list, other conferences that I have done the same thing, and they send an email out to the whole list saying, we have these various topics. Which one would you be interested in doing papers in any one of these topics or multiple topics?
Yeah, I think names, areas of expertise, and email contact. We should have that list, yeah.
And then if we just keep a database on possible reviewers of these various things.
We should, I think that we should, and I've already offered, you know, I said I would be willing to be an additional co-chair to Andres if necessary, you know, to help, you know, kind of bring my experience into it, since my experience is with the automated review process, and that's a new process, and to help him out with that.
That's good.
Yeah, now, with regard to the online review process, the online review process.
Turn it off, machine.
You want me to? I'm not sure how to do this. Between the computer and the camera. What I think I should do is, if we could move a table in front here. I was going to present that. Can you drag a table in front here? I'll try to show this. Not really sure how to do this. What? Well, if we ever produce it as a film, we can edit in the PowerPoint slides. That's not the point. But just a little slow to boot up.
Yeah, our cameraman.
Free room, right? Got me.
Have some chocolate.
Was that what I just did? Yeah.
Little word for chocolate.
Burnett?
Yes.
Yes.
Nicole?
Nice.
I guess I can press, read upside down and press it. Okay, the project I'm going to talk to you about is a project that I worked on from 1995 through 98 called the Stratosphere Observatory for Infrared Astronomy. And basically the project was to put a 2.7 meter infrared telescope in a 747. And the project will be completed in about a year or two. Now, what's infrared astronomy? Infrared astronomy is the study of electromagnetic radiation from in the infrared spectrum. That's heat, basically. Why do we need an airborne infrared telescope to do this? And, basically, the water vapor in the troposphere, that's the wet part of the atmosphere, blocks almost all the infrared radiation that comes in. And the troposphere extends to 12,400 meters altitude approximately, which is about 41,000 feet, although it varies in different places around the globe a little bit. Some places it's up to 44,000 feet. So what happens, in order to collect the infrared signal, you have to fly above the water vapor, above the troposphere, which puts you in the stratosphere. That's why it's called the Stratosphere Observatory. And there is another aspect to using an aircraft, which is a great advantage, which is that a lot of the infrared signals are extremely faint background radiation. Any type of radiation can have their very weak signals as well as strong signals. And with an airplane, you can fly west against the rotation of the Earth and track a star for up to an hour. Because the camera's points, maybe the telescope points, it's pointable to some extent. And so they will fly, keeping the camera on the star, so you collect a lot more light. And there's a little diagram of the troposphere with the water vapor, the stratosphere, the ozone, and space. There are infrared satellites that look at certain infrared sources, but for the real industrial use, it's an airborne telescope. Now, Ames has been flying infrared telescopes for something like 40 years, but the major plane before the Soviet Union was the Kuiper Airborne Observatory, or the KAO, and it flew from 1970 to 1995, and I was fortunate to fly on it to observe the crew, to get a better understanding of how it operates. And the Kuiper was a C-141 with a 9.9 meter telescope in front of the wings, just behind the cockpit. And so it has an opening cut out in the fuselage, and there's a little, I don't know what to call the term exactly, there's a little buffer, structural buffer to make the, to deflect the air from going in so it doesn't go into the cavity, and also to try to make as smooth as possible aerodynamic flow over the orifice. Now, this was the only plan I could find online a couple of hours for the Kuiper, and it's not too easy to see, but basically the cockpit is up front of the plane is up here. This blue area is the telescope, which is a pressure vessel vacuum chamber in the sense that it keeps this is an exterior temperature and pressure. So it's separated by a pressure barrier from the rest of the aircraft. Principal investigator, the science workstation, there are these three purple ones here, and the seats are here. They're very funny seats because they face backwards. Well, anyway, let's see that. And these were the so-called computer operator seats, and telescope operator seats. And then there are three other technician seats. These are computers and electronic support. And then there's an extra seat for people back here, and at the very back of the plane is a very large Here's a couple of shots of the telescope, again, not very good. See the way the telescope is mounted in the pressure vessel? The primary mirror is here, the secondary mirror is here. The primary mirror collects the infrared signal, reflects it to the secondary mirror, reflects it back down to a diagonal mirror, which puts it out through a tube called the Nasmyth tube. Now, this sort of circle you see here is an air bearing, a pressurized air bearing. It is what holds the telescope in place. And this telescope is actually structurally held in place by the mounting on this part of the pressure vessel. And then this here is the instrument, the collector, or the detector of infrared signals. And over the 25-year period, scientists at Ames developed an inventory of 15 instruments. And these are about up to about 1.5 meters long by a meter in diameter, maybe a little less than a meter in diameter. And they attach in various orientations. Some of them attach pointing down, some of them stick out, some of them to the side. And here's a view of that. Excuse me?
The size of the telescope?
0.9 meters. This mirror here is 0.9 meters.
Is that a cast grain?
Cast grain, yes. Cast grain.
Well, do you know what the focal length was?
What?
Do you know what the focal length was?
Or the focal length?
Diameter.
You know, I don't know the answer to that. I can find out for you, though.
It's not here.
So here's a couple of views inside Kuiper. Here's a view of a couple of the technicians at their consoles. This is the back console. Now this photograph is actually reversed. Whoever scanned this in, or whoever printed it backwards. But anyway, you're looking forward towards the principal investigator's seating area along this console. Oops. Here are some more images. This one is Halley's Comet in the infrared spectrum. This is the Shoemaker-Levy Comet and the Hercule Nebula. These are pictures from the infrared signal. And there's a whole lot of things that infrared astronomy does. It picks up certain emission spectra. For example, one of the major emission spectra for star formation, new star formation, is carbon monoxide. So there are people who go look for carbon monoxide signatures. This is a view of the principal investigator area, and you'll see that there's actually seats that face backwards and forwards here. And typically the principal investigator sits, or the staff sit here looking with their knees on the seat looking forward. This particular crew is a group from Lawrence Livermore Lab who were testing an infrared instrument of some kind against the stars. They weren't primarily astronomers, but they were trying to probably develop heat signatures for nuclear weapons development. And so here you see the so-called computer operator console, and the other consoles are back in here. Bye, Constance. It's fine. No vote.
Hey, you got people waving on the phones.
Okay, so the way this give me the organization chart. This is the organization chart of how the project developed. The project started as a partnership between NASA, Ames Research Center, and the German Space Agency, DLR, with NASA developing the aircraft and the onboard mission control system, and the Germans building the telescope and its telescope system. And the original cost breakdown was that the NASA part was supposed to be $240 million, and the German part was supposed to be $60 million, contributed by each of those governments. And it ended up costing more than that. And there were a lot of problems with the way this thing got started. profitable, they could just say, right, we're not using it anymore. So we put out a call for proposals for to build this. We got four proposals from Hughes Aircraft. United Space Research Association, Lockheed Martin, and somebody else. Anyway, a team led by University Space Research Associates, United Airlines, and Raytheon Systems in Waco, Texas, won. With United Airlines, well, first of all, one of the reasons they won was that United Airlines said, hey, we'll give you two 747s, no charge. They had a number of these 747 SPs, I'll show you the picture, which was the short plane that was about almost 10 meters shorter than a, no more than that, 15 meters shorter than a regular 747, and it was meant to sell for the so-called head of state market and the for long distance flights, and it was able to fly across the Pacific an hour faster than a regular 747, because it was lighter. You can also fly higher. So then the German team was made up of, I want to see two companies, there were actually three companies originally on the German team, Mann, Hazertrade, and there was Kaiser something else, that were the three teams. And whereas the US contract was a hierarchical contract structure where there was USRA was the prime contractor, and then they had their subs, and their subs had more subs. The German group was a consortium where there were three companies that had an equal role. It was kind of a cooperative effort. There was no hierarchy among them. And it was really hard matching up the American side and the German side from the organizational matching point of view. And the big problem was that we had an issue down in one of these subcontractors here for, say, the software or something, the programming that had to interface to the telescope. Remember, they had no contractual relationship or legal relationship with the Germans who were building the telescope. They had to send their communication up to USRA to NASA. NASA would send it across to DLR. DLR would send it down these companies, and they'd all have to look at it, all have to discuss it. And this has added several years to the project. But the other thing that was a unfortunate was the political side of how the project started, which was that when NASA and Congress agreed to start the project, the deal with the devil they made was that they would stop flying the Kuiper. Type of operational budget would be added to the budget to build Sophia. But once we started working on the serious engineering development of Sophia, Kuiper would stop flying. And that immediately became a huge problem because we needed to teach the Germans how our airborne observatory operated. It's a very complicated operation to fly the plane, point the telescope, collect the data, assess the data in real time, whether you're getting a good signal, repoint the telescope, and so on, and then look for other targets of opportunity, and you can see that there were a number of operators in the way the old system worked. So, what NASA did was we sent a team of about a dozen people to Germany armed with thousands of viewgraphs on viewfoils on plastic, and to give the Germans 2 weeks of viewgraph presentations with simultaneous translation. And we did this several times, and each time that American team would come back and holding their heads and, oh, if you could just fly the Kuiper over there and take them up in it one time, they would understand. Yeah. And I went to the Pratt Center and said, look, this is going to cost you millions of dollars, a huge delay. And what you should do is just take your contingency budget and fly the Kuiper over there for 2 weeks, take all the German engineers up, show them how the thing works. Because you really cannot understand it or describe it unless you see it in operation. It's one of those things that no amount of viewgraphs or reading text will explain it to you what the operating environment is like. So there were, there were many questions that were really not that difficult questions, but that had to be resolved. But it just, there was such a different understanding of what the operation should be. And the, not that the American understanding is necessarily the correct one to transfer from the Kuiper to the Sophia, but there wasn't enough common background to even discuss it properly. Anyway.
But it's always more if you want to explain architecture to somebody, you just might also want to take that person to a building, you know? And
yes, ideally you would, yeah, but this was a shortcoming. I came on board to do a job that was called the Landlord Personnel Accommodation, to welcome the design of the crew cabin, and it included the layout of the onboard mission control system console. Now, what I showed you in the Kuiper, the onboard mission control system consisted of the racks that ran longitudinally in the cabin. So what we basically had in the Kuiper is we had a set of racks that were set up like this with six seats like that. That was the onboard mission control system. And one of the things, and the principal investigator seats and console were like here. Well, this is a tourist trip. Tourist triplets and like economy seats, two economy seats on the aircraft back to back. You know, on a regular airplane, you have three seats. So that these are tourist triplets, two that are back to back. Anyway, so I just checked to see where the camera was. Yeah. So anyway, so this was the layout that we had, like this. And telescope here. One of the interesting things I noticed was that the scientists always kept one eye on the telescope. The telescope is moving all the time. The way it operates is it takes a snapshot of the target and then it nods to point at a piece of black sky with nothing in it to recalibrate and points back. And it does this maybe every 15 or 30 seconds. And it has slightly different angular things. And the scientists who are really familiar with it are watching it to see how it performs in addition to watching everything else. So they want to be really close. Now, the question that we had, if we're doing the 747, that I had, was does this sort of layout make any sense? Everybody wants to have closer access to the telescope, and so on. That was kind of the top level question. And then?
Can you explain why the arrangement is as it is?
These were standard electronics racks that were integrated outside the airplane and assembled and just rolled them through the back of the plane in two big units.
Why did you place them there?
This is 25, this was before.
Okay, before you came on.
Yeah, this is the way the old one was, and it was done for the ease of assembling the electronics and moving them into the airplane.
And the three tourist triples are for the researchers when they're taking off and landing?
Right, taking off and landing, right. And the principal investigator usually sits here in the back seat looking over everything.
Knees
on the seat. What? Only for takeoff and landing, but when they're operating, he sits here. He sits here with the knees on the seat and watching everything. That's just the way it evolved. So anyway, some of them stand up, some of them move around, but. I'm just saying that was kind of the favorite place. It wasn't the only place, the favorite place. So Now, when I came on the project, I was supposed to collect, I was supposed to figure out how to design the layout. And there were a lot of things that nobody had done yet, such as find out how many people we were going to have on the plane, how many consoles, how many science equipment racks, how they were going to be, how are they going to relate to each other. It might be the same or different from the Kuiper, and how the different, how the operational regime differed. And this is kind of the experience that Constance described to you yesterday, where with the help of the checks, the health maintenance facility for the space station, crew health facility, except that she was dealing with a far more fragmented and dysfunctional organization than here. This team was working really well, and pretty much all the engineers knew who they needed to talk to get the information they needed, but nobody had the big put together the big picture for how does this affect the design of the crew cab. And, you know, if I might just use this room, we had a crew cab areas from that wall to that wall, maybe from this wall over to the side, that side of the first window. So it's a fairly large area that we were going to be laying out for this equipment. And so it was necessary to do an assessment here. Now, this is too small for you to see, but what I did was I collected data on the Kuiper and what was going to happen with the Sophia. And let me just come around here so I can see this a little better. Basically, the big changes from the Kuiper to the Sophia were when you talk to all the engineers and the scientists, what they would say, I was asking, well, how will Sophia be different from the Kuiper? It's like, oh, we're going to have 100,000 times better data rate, we'll have 1,000 times better resolution, or whatever. We can fly twice as often. But there were a lot of other things that were architecturally more significant that nobody had really identified or articulated. So the Kuiper flew an average of 80 times a year. The Sophia would fly 160 times a year. So that's a change of 100%. The number of support flights a year would double from 20 to 40. Those are other aircraft that bring people and supplies to wherever the aircraft is deployed around the world. They fly from different locations all around the world, depending on what they want to look at what time of year. Now, the down days between observation flights became a very significant driver, because we're going from 265 down days a year, that's days you're not flying, to about 165. That's a decrease of 40%. But that gives us change the ratio down days to flying days from 3 to 1 with the Kuiper. We have 3 down days for every day we fly. To with the Sophia, we were going to have only 1 down day for every day we flew, which is a huge, huge change for the maintenance. And as you'll see, ultimately, almost everything we did, we're designing the plane for the maintenance crew. That was the most common demand and interface on everything was the maintenance crew. We're now going to have only a third of the time to maintain the plane that they were having with the old plane. Plane instruments, number of targets did not change that much. We were changing from 100 bright targets to 200 bright targets. And, or dimmer bright, actually, this table is not correct, but basically we're going from a capability of imaging up to 100 targets in one flight to 200, although most flights it was 10 to 20, but the capability would go from 100 to 200, so theoretically it was. Crew, this is another big change. They wanted to go to a highly automated crew. The nominal mission crew, that two, four members on the Kuiper as a normal number to two on the Sophia. And this meant a much higher level of automation. The number of crew mission trainees would be the same, two. The number of principal investigator teams that could fly at one time would increase from two on the Kuiper to three on the Sophia. The number of science team members would increase from the range of 4 to 6 to the range of 4 to 15. So that's an increase of about 275% potentially. The number of science racks could grow from 2 to 5. And the number of hangers on, other guests, observers, engineers, news media, teachers, would also have a big increase. Because the crew cabin was supposed to have up to 44 seats when we were finished, as opposed to 15 or 18 on the, I think we actually had 18 on the Kuiper. So here's just a diagram of the telescope showing what I told you about before.
Most of,
yes.
After you went through the analysis, when you told us what the requirements were, if possible, you could draw the configuration that you came up with so that we can relate based on this.
Let me just go through a little more analysis and I will do that. So the really significant thing here is the length of this tube here, where the signal to the nasal tube. This ends up being a 2 meter nasal tube and an instrument up to 2 meters. So this piece here can be 4 meters long. It's projecting into the crew cabin. So another dimension of the analysis was the teamwork, where I identified that there were 5 different teams: the mission ops, the science team, the education team, engineering development and support, and the ground support team. And what you see here is that the ground support team is involved in more aspects of the operation than any of the other teams. So then I also identified 5 different flight scenarios, which were the so-called normal science flight and engineering flight, which is to test and check out equipment, and pilot training flight, a ferry flight where they're just going to an operational base, and a ferry science flight, which is a peculiar hybrid where they try to do some science while they're ferrying. And each of these has different numbers across essentially the same number of categories of crew members and the operations. This is just an example of the data I had to compile and analyze. So the next big issue was the allocation of the number of consoles we were going to have. And there were, in my analysis, I determined that there were basically 4 major types of units, which was the operator console, which operated the telescope and the onboard mission control system, which is called an MCCS, switch panel, which belonged really just to the mission manager, who was kind of the civil servant who was running what was going on in the airplane, the mobile science racks, which are the science racks, and then the permanent facility racks, which are like permanent science racks. And who among the different people on board would sit at each of these types of consoles, or need to have proximity to each of these different types of consoles. And finally, there was the issue of distribution of the console control and functionality to the operators. And this was actually a very controversial topic, which is the degree of control. There were 3 degrees of control that people talked about, although not in a systematic way. There was what they call active control, selective control, and passive control, which basically meant no control, you're just an observer. And what they were doing, was proposing, was that the mission ops, the mission manager, the mission operations director, had active console with hardware keys to all the other consoles. Every console had a physical key lockout to whether it was turned on or off. And then the mission specialists had active control over everything. The scientists and engineering development people would have so-called selective control of the consoles they were assigned. They could handle some fun, work with some functions, and then everybody else except trainees had only observer passive consoles, although trainees had an active console they could kind of test drive a little bit from. All right, so here's a picture of the Sophia in flight. The black square here is a 4 meter square that shows where the plane is going to be cut out. This photograph was taken before it went into the factory to have that hole cut. Here's a view of the actual telescope, the 2.7 meter telescope, going through what they call a mirror lift, where they're putting it into the airplane. And a major part of the maintenance ground support was the fact that this system is designed so they can take the telescope out easily, take it apart, take the mirrors out, repolish it, recoat the mirrors. Because one of the things that happens is that the mirror has some wear, and they actually have to replace the coat. Refurbish the coating on it about once a year. And here's a view of the interior of the aircraft as it looked most recently in the factory. The top, all the panels have been stripped out, so you see the longerons and ribs and the fuselage. This circle, set of circles here is the pressure bulkhead. It's 50 centimeters thick to hold up the cabin pressure. This side is pressurized, the other side is not. It has a large air bearing in the middle.
And this show how
large a person
would be?
A larger person
would
be?
Yeah.
This is 2 meters here, about. So a person would be about this big, or about this big. And here's a view of the telescope installed in the cabin, the unpressurized cabin. And here's the pressure bulkhead on the other side. And there's a close-up view of the nasal tube with a rack, an equipment rack put on here, just I think essentially for the spatial envelope.
Okay, Mark, how much of that had to be designed specifically for this project?
Everything was designed for this project, absolutely everything, except for the 15 science instruments in the existing inventory. But there are new instruments that are being built that are much larger than the old ones. Okay, now what's the layout of the new aircraft? Let's see here. We have the pressure bulkhead. The telescope is here. The Nasmyth tube comes through here. An instrument can sit on the end of the nasal tube. None of this is really to scale, but you look at the idea. This is the air bearing. There's actually a pit under here for access to the bulkhead. It goes down into the underfloor area. The floor is removed here, but not under the crew deck. This is the crew deck. The layout that I designed basically put the consoles, like I actually went through a number of designs where I kept in what was my final design, I kept the center aisle very wide. The center aisle here is about 1.5 meters wide, and there's a set of consoles and science racks with the mission operators here and the science principal investigator here, and then there are several sets of these for different functions. And there was a conference table was over here, something like this, and there's a printer station, because we have printers and fax machines and a lot of other communications and data analysis equipment. And there's backup science equipment. Now, One of the things that emerged that was a really fascinating cultural issue was that the scientists had, over the years, had developed a deep distrust of the mission operations technicians because they would modify the equipment without consulting the scientists. And actually, in some cases, they made certain systems harder to operate because they didn't want the scientists to make adjustments. Because one of the things the scientists would do while they were operating is if they didn't think something was adjusted properly, they'd go over to a mission technician's console and start pressing buttons and turning knobs. So the mission technicians felt they had to protect the consoles from the scientists. Well, the scientists always thought they knew better, and the mission specialists thought the scientists were, you know, being too intrusive. And one of the things they did was there was a certain adjustment for the telescope operating system that used to be adjusted by a knob that turned on one of these console positions here, and the scientists would go over to it and turn it. So what the and messed the other things up because a whole bunch of things had to be adjusted in concert with that. So what one of the technicians did one night was he came in and he removed this thing from the console and he put it underneath inside the rack, took the knob off, and put just a little flathead screwdriver, a screw into the top of it. And scientists came in, they didn't know where to control it. Now, and then anytime they needed to have it adjusted, they have to get a technician to unlock the bottom of the cabinet, stick his arm in with a screwdriver, and turn the screwdriver. And they also locked up the screwdrivers on board. So anyway.
Its
the balance analysis was that the plane was too tail heavy, because the telescope and bulkhead proved to be heavy. The bulkhead especially proved to be heavier than what was initially predicted. So to move the center of gravity of the plane forward, they did two things. They installed lead plates in the floor of the nose, on the front cabin, just to put more weight. They put several tons of lead right in the very front of the plane, attached to the floor. And we moved all these consoles back about 4 meters, 4 or 5 meters, well, it all moved away from this. So now this is a big wide open area. The other thing that happened, which was actually consistent with one of my study plans, was that they decided to change where the aisle was, the center aisle. Now, originally they all said, oh, we want to be able to take the instrument straight out all the way and lay it down. We don't want to have to turn it at all. And so with that, but we also want to be as close as possible. So for that reason, I put these as close as we could get it with a wide aisle so the instrument could come straight off and down the corridor and go back, you know, install it this way. However, once we had about 4 meters here, that was no longer a problem, and because of the fact that this only door we had, this down only hatch we had, was over here to get in, they took one of the options I had done earlier, and we moved moved these consoles over to here. So all the stuff moved over, and we ended up with the aisle over here, but otherwise everything's the same. And this meant that we had less circulation space overall. And so that was okay. That was actually something I had proposed, and the scientists had all rejected it. They said, no, we want to pull it straight out. We want the study corridor. And then, but later, we did move it over. So.
If I were a PI and I was sitting on that chair, okay, what's the kind of visual access I have, and how many hours am I in that plane? How many hours do I spend as a PI?
Oh, it basically flies at night. So you take off at dusk, you can fly for 8 or 10 hours and turn it on.
And the PI is there all the 8 hours? Well, the PI is not on board during the train.
We're talking about people on the plane the whole time. Everybody's on board. Yeah, oh no, the PIs are very, very actively involved.
And what kind of visual access do I have while being on the plane? I can look at the consoles, I can look at the backs of the technicians, and look outside at all?
Yeah, there are windows. It's when it's finished, it should be like a regular cabin. They'll put all the wall panels, insulation wall panels back up. It'll be like a regular 747 cabin.
And they wouldn't sleep
from about here to here. What?
If there were 8 hours on that flight, they didn't need to lie down or something. 8 hours of flying, would be resting cabin or something.
No, because these people are really serious astronomers. They tend to be completely nocturnal or awake at night and sleep in the day.
So. Stretching out.
I'm exaggerating a little, but that you can tilt your seat back, and actually on the lower level we preserve the first class. We're preserving the first class seats, so there are about in the nose under the cockpit. There's about a dozen seats that lie flat, so it is possible. But the reason they kept those was for deployment flights. So if they're flying to New Zealand, where we have a little base for the Sophia at some airport in New Zealand, they fly from Ames to New Zealand. That's where the crew can sleep on the long flight, day or night, you know, whatever, when there's nothing else, nothing to do.
What do they have up in the first class hump behind the cockpit?
That is, they have seats there too. Yeah, that was, at one point we were going to make that into a conference room, but actually I think they just decided to leave it as seats.
You know how like the MD-11s and some of that, they have a dedicated crew rest space? They didn't have anything like that. Well, I guess you were just saying that they used the seats
on the lower level for the crew
bars? I believe there is the two crew bar behind the cockpit. I could observe that.
Mark, you want to change the
tape? Oh yeah, sure. Let's take a look here. Any other questions? Very good.
What was I still don't understand, what was the project about? Was the to focus the telescope for you, or the design, the interior design, the arrangement?
Well, the assignment, the project for me, was the organizational layout of this, and it also involved getting involved with the functionality of the onboard mission control consoles, and the connections to the PI, to the science consoles, and to the maintenance facilities. There's a lot of tools that are involved for adjusting these science racks, which were just loaded with all kinds of instrumentation. And that, I had to understand and work with that. There were questions that had to do with how are we going to do the auxiliary power, because one of the things they had to do because of weight and because of safety of the fuel line was the 747 has its auxiliary power unit in the tail, and it's considered by airline pilots to be the best auxiliary power unit flying. So the way they start the engine is they have a little basically generator in the tail as an auxiliary power unit, and they turn that on and it blows air through ducts to out the wings to start the fans turning, to start the engines. And because we had to eliminate that, we need to find another location for, are we
offering? 3 minutes.
Okay, to put that in. And so what they ended up deciding to do was to buy a separate auxiliary power unit to go in the forward cargo hold.
So why is it that, is that a presentation by the
What?
What is that kind of presentation? Because the design is not included in there. It just talks about.
Oh, I just didn't have any of my design drawings on my laptop. I did extensive CAD drawings and hand drawings. I did hundreds of drawings to develop the design. I went through many stages of review, many analyses, and I do like 10 different plans and present them and get responses and feedback on the design. It was a very long interview process of others. Plus we wrote three big reports, which I can send you copies of. We wrote three big reports, and we built some scale models.
I did an education. What is in this paper or this presentation in the computer?
I just did that this morning.
What?
I just made this presentation this morning.
What
I had in my computer and what I could download from the web in about 3 hours this morning. And I'm sorry, I don't have any of the CAD drawing, but I did very expensive 3D solid CAD for this to lay this out, many options.
And did you include the first deck, I mean the first class deck with this sleeping or relaxing seats?
The ones where we did that are on the lower level, below the nose. The United Airlines first class was on the lower level of the nose. The business class is up behind the cockpit.
Yeah, I just wondered if that was part of the concept.
Yeah, that was part of the concept. Yeah, that was part of it, but I wasn't working on that. I mean, it was not a project to say, okay, we're going to leave the first class section the way it is. Side project, yeah. But this was what's happening in the main cabin of the airplane, and it was basically to pull this all together and make this an architectural totality with long-term planning, considering all the functionality, do all the research, put it together in a big picture, and make it work. And yeah, I got involved with a lot of technical stuff. One of the really big issues we had to resolve was what the height of the air bearing would be relative to the floor deck. obvious and logical thing was to put it right on center. But what I found in doing my analysis was that in this static envelope of the maximum range of the maximum increment, put it a little more than 1 centimeter above the floor. And I thought that was too close, especially if there was some flexibility in this 4 meter long structure when the whole thing was assembled. And so we had a really big debate about how high to make this thing and so on. And at one point, I had them almost convinced that they needed to raise this at least a centimeter.
So what is it, what lights did you use? Did they also have a kind of galley or something?
Yes, we kept one of the galleys.
I mean, it's a kind of office space. I mean, that's what it is. It's an office. It's a blind office.
It's like a fly fishing